Today we'll discuss the topic of how to count the political prisoners. Should there be new criteria? We'll discuss the whole issue for 2 hours. First, we'll have a discussion with experts, and during the second hour, we'll have a Q&A. Here we have Oleg Bulak, the chairman of the Belarusian Helsinki Committee. Oleg Agiev, a lawyer and deputy chair of the Belarusian Association of Journalists. Hello. And Vyacheslav Kasinero, founder of the initiative helping political prisoners, dissident.by. Hello, Vyacheslav. I would like to remind you that we record the session. Also would like to remind you that we follow the Chatham House rules, which means that if you tell us in advance, you would not want your part of your quote to be to end up in the final YouTube recording, please let us know. Then all the other participants of discussion will know that they will not quote you on that. Also, we have a simultaneous interpretation available into English. If it's easier for you to listen to us in English, please select the relevant option. All your questions and commentaries, you can ask them in the chat and raise your hand if you want to ask the question. I'd like to give floor now to my co-moderator, Vadim Mazhejka. Vadim, please. Thank you, Anton. Good morning, colleagues. Good evening. Today we have a penultimate expert analytical club session. We talk today on the topic that unfortunately is still relevant and is getting relevant more and more. It used to be less than 900 political prisoners. Now it's over 900 political prisoners in our country. The number is growing. Today we'll be discussing the number of participants of political prisoners and the ways to calculate them. There are a lot of ways to count them, and we'll discuss today the ways to do it. We all understand that whatever we all think about this, we condemned the presence of political prisoners in Belarus, despite any criteria that may be used to count them. The issue is very important. To understand it better, we hold an expert discussion like this one. Today we'll discuss how we define political prisoners today. What are the suggestions here? What are the advantages and disadvantages? What are the threats? And how to deal with the whole issue? I suggest that we move today in the order in the following way. First, we'll discuss how the people are recognized as political prisoners, the mechanism. It doesn't happen on its own. It's done by the human defense lawyers. Then we'll discuss the suggestions and the threats and advantages. I suggest we start with Oleg. We have two Olegs here today. I suggest we hear more detail now about the methodology and about the procedure of how people are recognized as political prisoners by human defense lawyers. What happens between two points when the person gets in jail and is recognized as political prisoners? I'm sure that many people don't really know much about the methodology. So let's get clear about this to understand what we're talking about. I suggest that Oleg Bulak starts. So how does it work these days? Good afternoon, everyone, once again. In fact, I'll be brief about this because I hope that people who will join us today for the discussion. They know about this. They at least have read about the criteria adopted in the human defense community. Otherwise, there's no reason to retell the things that are quite complicated, because the procedure is not so easy. It's not about just political prisoners, people calling them political prisoners. If we want this to have a meaning to it, we should be serious about it. If we go back, we'll see that the criteria is a product that became the result of a long-term experience of human defense lawyers working with the issue of human rights violations. At some point, we decided and we understood that we want more clarity about the origins of such terms and the people who recognize as political prisoners. Hence, we came up with a solution. It was an international impulse, and together with our colleagues from post-Soviet space, we worked a lot on this. We had a lot of meetings, a lot of discussions, wrote a lot of texts. Eventually, there appeared a document which is now public and is now available in the websites of the Lord human rights organizations. These criteria are not owned by us, they are also applied in Russia, Ukraine. I'm not sure about Kazakhstan, but there's a whole range of human defense lawyers that participated in development of these guidelines. Right, let's go back to what I was saying. So these guidelines were the product of work of many human defense lawyers from different countries. This is what's happening now. When we see that people get in jail or criminally persecuted, if there's a reason to believe that such people could be recognized as political prisoners, some human defense lawyers or journalists, like representatives of the Belarusian Association of Journalists, they initiate the open process. There could be a suggestion that in this very case, we believe that this person should be recognized as political prisoner. Why? Because this and that. Then we discuss how much the concrete case falls under the criteria used to recognize people as political prisoners. Then we have a joint voting. If the organizations support this motion, nobody was against this. Nobody said that this case does not fall under the criteria, then the decision is taken, it's made public, and we add this person to the list of the recognized political prisoners. That's in a nutshell. Oleg, do you want to add anything? Indeed, just like Oleg said, this document is called the guidelines, used to define that to recognize people as political prisoners. It was preceded by a long-term period of work. Many people took part in the discussions before this document was approved. For the Belarusian community, since it was developed by the human defense lawyers coming from many countries, for Belarusian, we approved it at the meeting, joint meeting of the human defense organizations. Everyone who was present at the forum agreed on the formulas, on the and on the approaches to recognize people as political prisoners. Oleg Gulag indeed defined how this procedure is applied these days. Thank you very much. I would like to clarify one thing. You just said that you approved of these guidelines at the forum. When did this forum take place, and how long did it take you to discuss these guidelines? I believe it was 2016, if my memory serves me correct. I think it was earlier than that. I need to check. I'm so used to those criteria that I don't really remember when we initiated them. I think it was not 5 years ago, but earlier than this. I think it took us about a year to develop these criteria. I believe it could have taken us even more than a year. There was a working group created for this purpose. So I think it happened in the last decade, right? After 2010 and 2011. Right. Just for us to understand how fresh this initiative is. Vadim, we could also remember the fact that in the modern history of Belarus, I mean, and after our country gained independence in 1991, the political prisoners in the country appeared in 1996. We never had after that a period with no political prisoner at all. All those periods were short when everybody was set free. But I guess at any point of time after 1996, there were two or three or several dozens of those after 2010 that were in jail. Just for reference, in the third law defense forum in Vilnius in 2013, we adopted those criteria. Vyacheslav Kisnerov is raising his hand. Now we know when the criteria appeared. It's time to discuss whether there are concrete proposals to change them. How come the number of political prisoners is growing so fast? Vyacheslav Kisnerov from disney.by, please. What do you think should be changed in the criteria? I just wanted to remind my colleagues that it was in 2013 that the criteria were approved. The criteria of PAC were adopted in 2012. As to the process, The definition of who is human defense lawyer follows that it could be in any person or organization that is doing everything to defend human rights alone or together with colleagues. It's important to understand because we're hearing these days about the single human rights community that making the defense cases. I would disagree with that because the majority of us here have to do with work with human defense activities. We help people whose rights have been violated. As to the recognition approaches, I didn't really understand the question. Should I describe how the process is happening or why the number of the human political prisoners is growing? Ideally, when we were planning this session, we were planning four speakers to have two on two. There were hard to find people, two people that were in favor of amending the approaches. Unfortunately, there are other people. I suggest, I believe there are other suggestions about the applying other criteria. We believe people become recognized people as political prisoners, not only because we sympathize with them. We sympathize with many people who are now in jail, who are kept in inhuman conditions. Even those who are detained for petty hooliganism. But since we're talking about today about the status of political prisoners, we would like to know what concrete amendments you suggest that be applied in this case. Right, it's much easier now. In this case, the idea is that we do not suggest any new criteria. What we suggest is to make more relevant the criteria that have been used, the fact that they are great. The criteria of the PAC is fantastic. I suggest you read them. It's important that they started to be misinterpreted in 2020. We spoke about this in 2017. We said that the authorities are learning. They are making provocations so that people fall into the trap, and when they get in jail, they don't have the status of political prisoner. There are a lot of examples like that. As to the legal collapse that has been with us for over half a year and a half, it's clear that the approaches that are used are not particularly relevant these days. Starting from the basic rights of the people violated, should not be considered part of the legitimate system that could help us to deal with this from the legal standpoint. What we propose is to follow the criteria, but we need to consider the repressive machine and the legal collapse that we are facing now. We need to understand that the detention of the people, which has been proved by a huge number of facts and documented, that is conducted with violence. The people are subjected to torture. The private life is interfered with, the belongings are removed from people illegally. So saying now that we should use the Amnesty International interpretation, the prisoner of conscience, is not particularly relevant. Now the basic human rights, like the right to life, are regularly violated by the authorities. They are commonplace. And we need to discuss this later on. These are parts of the natural rights that people have that became the foundation of the Declaration of the Human Rights. The other day, I saw that all the rights listed in the international normative acts and documents are systemically violated in Belarus. The discrimination here is based on the views of people, irrelevant of humans, people's belongings, whether they are liberals or communists and so on. Some colleagues of ours say that these rules are adhered to by colleagues in Russia, other countries, and maybe in Europe. We're just saying that currently in Belarus we're facing a legal collapse. Belarus is in an awful state. Some people call it genocide, some people call it other names. Based on this, what we're saying is that Belarus requires another interpretation of criteria used to recognize people as political prisoners. And based on this, our list may include also the people who wanted to resist the system, the violence, the torture and the murder by the illegitimate authorities that were not recognized by anyone in the world. Thank you, Vyacheslav. I believe it's about the difference between the 900 2400. So about 1500 cases when the charges are based on the fact that the people detained were resisting the arrest. Again, is that it or is there any other differences? It's 1200 people particularly jailed. The full list includes everyone who have been already freed. So this is not a stable list. It's not about recognizing 1,200 more people as political prisoners. It's about the fact that people who will work are subject to this. I believe the authorities launched 4,691 cases over the protest. And it shows that even being a volunteer could get a person in jail. The main contradiction here is simple and difficult at the same time. We have a number of cases that we could discuss. Thank you very much, Vyacheslav. Right, we have discussed the different methodologies and we are now clear about the proposals about the amendments. Let's imagine now that the amendments of the criteria, their update has happened and have been approved. According to this update, the majority of people in jail are recognized as political prisoners. Let's discuss what advantages and threats this can entail, what can become better and what can become worse. And this will explain why there are proposals to make these amendments and why they have not been approved yet. Let's start in the same order. Oleg Nikolaevich, please. In order to be more clear, I wanted to ask a question about you say that we need to change our approaches because the situation is different. I agree, the situation has become worse. And all these violations that the colleague of ours has mentioned, they exist. But why should we amend the criteria in this case? That I don't understand. The situation has indeed changed, but does it really mean that the criteria should also change? Since there is a question, there should be an answer. Vyacheslav, what do you say to that? It's actually quite easy, because in the past, when the person was jailed for political reasons, could count on the fact that they would not be tortured, violated, or murdered. His parents would not be jailed for him. Now, the situation has changed. That sadistic practices are the norm. We have a lot of materials, and by researching these materials and watching these videos when people are saying that they're sorry for what they've done or not really have done, we understand that these people are afraid. There's people could be subject to the Middle Ages practices of torture and violation. So the big question is, how do we help them protect their rights? Without a doubt, each person these days, each person who has a knock on the door or who's chased in the street by people who are in plain clothes without any uniform, all these people, they saw other victims of the regime, and they believe that they could be next. In this case, the activities that they undertake must be protected with the democratic governments in place. We may understand and find out whether this person was recognized as a political prisoner properly. But meanwhile, we want this person to receive adequate medical help, to receive parcels and so on, that are connected with the status of a political prisoner. Thank you very much, Vyacheslav. So basically what we're saying is that in general, Belarus is now a new status from the totalitarian state, has become a country that is particularly a violent state. And it requires certain responses. Oleg Nikolaevich, let's imagine we have widened the criteria toolkit. What are the advantages and disadvantages of that? I don't really like the approach when you say that it's important to recognize people as political prisoners. The major idea is anyways, we do it not because particular benefits for these people to receive. This recognition is something that confirms this situation. In this sense, the violence here plays an important role. It all boils down to the necessary protective. We need to discuss this further. And we do it when we get together to discuss it. And my disclaimer here is that, of course, a human rights defender, anyone could be a human rights defender. Nobody requires any special ID for that. Human rights defenders are people who decided to protect other humans' rights. But when we talk about people being recognized as political prisoners, we see a coalition of organizations that share particular values of these principles and criteria. And they understand this logic. They have demonstrated their professional approaches. This way, we have a coalition that recognizes people as political prisoners. Some people join it, some people leave it. It's a flexible process. The organizations that agree to such approaches, they join the coalition. What will happen? I believe the following could happen. If we show that we apply the status without the deep analysis, if we start applying the principle of the presumption of innocence, not about the people who get judged, but about the presumption of innocence towards the state and the persecutors, this will significantly undermine the trust to the recognition to the status of the human rights defenders and to the activities of the human rights defenders, because the political prisoner is not a legal status. It's not a legal procedure or frame. Status that is or is not trusted. It's possible to lose the authority, but it's difficult to gain back the trust of people. So I'm afraid that I don't see any sense in the changes, because the procedure is working properly and the context is right. Currently, there are proposals to have a wider approach to recognition, and we are against that. As soon as we have those things mixed, move away from the content, we risk this losing any meaning. And risk this as to this assistance that is connected to this status, this assistance, I believe, is not directly connected with the status of a political prisoner. People who have suffered require this help. The number of people who suffered on political grounds is much longer. Indeed, this issue is much wider than the issue of political business. So it's always using this approach to provide people with additional assistance and attention is wrong. I believe it's wrong. Thank you, Oleg. Right, we have another Oleg. The floor is yours. Do you have anything to add? Are there any other threats? But could there be any advantages if we make the list of political prisoners longer, if we update the current procedure? I would divide the proposals into two parts, just like Vyacheslav said. For me personally, a big plus here is the universal nature of the approach. It is widely used in the countries where people are politically persecuted, where people in jail. On a number of covered by a number of criteria, they make them political prisoners. Everybody knows what is behind this term. If the amendment to that criteria will lead to the situation when people follow the same criteria using a different understanding, I think this could be fraught with danger. As to the changes proposed, out of what I understood by reading what is written on the distinct.by website, I believe it's about the requirements that a person should not be recognized as political prisoner if should be recognized as political prisoner if a person has been arrested on violent reasons. But here we need also to remember the issue of justifiable defense. As Oleg Gulak said, a long time is needed to exclude this term, and the person who is charged with violent actions can be recognized as political prisoner if during the monitoring of the information about this case done by the law human rights defenders. If the guidelines have serious principles and I'm not ready to give up on them. I believe that if a person conducts violent actions, we need to follow this case more closely. And if a person is charged with violent actions, this requires additional time. So I believe we should treat with understanding the idea that not everyone could be recognized as political prisoners. Human rights community requires immediate release of political prisoners, but in certain cases, we require the review of the cases following the justice procedures. This is a major difference in the status of the political prisoners, because indeed there could be two categories, either immediate release or review of the case. I will repeat myself, saying that it's too early to give up on the criteria we have now. I suggest we monitor the certain cases more seriously. If there's a requirement to recognize certain people as political prisoner, it is possible to do, and it should be done. Thank you, Oleg. I I remember that they're very complicated cases. I believe there was this case several years ago when some young people were throwing Molotov cocktails at the DDF building, and I think they were sentenced to 7 years in prison. We understood, all understand that 7 years is too long for that, but the throwing Molotov cocktails is not a good action in itself. Vyacheslav, back to you. What are the threats, do you think, of your proposals, and what could be the advantages if we make the criteria wider? Apart from the photographs of such people appeared on the websites, and they will get more letters and more money, what other advantages there are? Thank you. I start by a small commentary because I'm the only person with my position and my proposals. Firstly, nobody says the coalition of human defense lawyers is not professional. We applaud your experience and your work, but there are some things we disagree with. Nobody says that human rights defense approaches that you apply should not exist. But we believe that there should not be a universal approach to everyone, because this is a sign of stagnation. The stability is bad here. So I believe the conflict situation requires development. Some of you said that we maybe not going deep enough to analyze these ideas and this situation. I'm not going to tell you how we are dealing with the cases, what our principles are. I'm ready to have a separate discussion on this, on the sidelines, as they say. As to the deep analysis, I'm going back to this saying that we do read the statements by human rights defense organization, Viasna, and other similar agencies, and they say that based on the video published on propagandist channels, I quote here, if we believe the video posted in the propagandist channel, how deep is this analysis? That is my question. As to the what was mentioned about the political prisoner status, for some reason, my colleagues here mentioned the authority and the high authority of the status. I'm actually appalled by this because I'm thinking about the people that are for the international community and for Belarusians are the criminals or non-criminals. Without a person without the status is a criminal with some potential political past. And this devaluation here is wrong. The most important thing is the the good name of the person who did something to protect himself or to protect democracy, or if they did something just to be violent. It's important to understand that the Belarusian realia are special. Nobody killed the police staff, nobody beat the police staff we don't have a single case in the court where a person was charged with exceeding the justifiable defense or necessary defense. And when this is applied, it means that this the authorities are violating the human rights of people that they charged with this. Secondly, the status of political prisoner makes the person more visible. Person does something, they're visible for the community. Again, this is a good name approach. Another point is that the colleagues are constantly using the term violence. Violence is not about burning somebody's door and spoiling somebody's tire. It's about the damaging somebody's property. There are very few cases when the violence was used by the protesters, but the violence on, from the side of law enforcement is a usual instance. It's important to understand that the people who damage to somebody else's property, let's say the policeman property, we're doing this for political reasons, not for the violent reasons as such. I'm not a judge, I'm not an expert here, but I know this is not violent action. The Molotov cocktails that you mentioned and others, the Zolotaryov case is very important here to mention. All these people said they didn't want to damage the people's property. What they wanted to show is a symbolic act and does not fall under the category of heavy damage and gross damage. So, but the use of the violence, term violence, to apply to all such cases is wrong. I wouldn't do that. Again, based on what is happening in front of my eyes, I saw people getting killed in videos. I saw interviews of people who were kneeled and violated and raped. I can't say this, the person who is now in Belarus should not be afraid of this. As human rights defenders, we should consider the cases where the some cases of people's rights are violated. It was the choice of the every person to defend themselves or not. If we see that the person is forced on video after beating the person, if the person is forced to say that they've made a mistake, this case should be obvious. If the person, if the authorities say this person did this or that damage for political reasons, and they destroy people's correspondence and things, thus violating almost all the rights listed in the Declaration of Human Rights, this is wrong. I believe that politicians and political party leaders should deal with that. I would like to remind you that we have a big number of participants in Zoom that directly work the human right defense. So I suggest that everyone who wants to take part in the discussion use the raise your hand button in the Zoom. then Anton will see it, and later we'll be able to give you the floor for you to take part in the discussion. I would like to remind you that we have the main set of speakers and other speakers. We spoke about a lot of things in theory. Let's talk about the concrete cases. Be interested for me to hear what some of our speakers think about this. I have a small reply to make. I remember very well the video that I saw. I think it was one of the first few days after the election in August 2020. I think it was in Pritetskoye Street. There's a cordon of police trying to detain a driver. The driver hits and runs. Some of my colleagues remember this story very well. I believe somebody this driver was detained later on. He was trying to sink his car. I'm afraid the person, this driver, was not treated according to law. What do we do in such case? There is an obvious threat that the driver could face. He could see these people out of the window of his car. On the other hand, this person hits several people and didn't know what would happen to them. I don't remember the names. I don't remember the name of such person, whether he was recognized as political prisoner. Should we recognize people in such cases as political prisoners? We're not democratic judges. And it's difficult for us to understand whether he was acting based on the necessary defense. Let's follow the same order, Oleg Polak wanted to add something, and then follow the same order to discuss this case. I wanted to say that, reply to what Viasna was saying. As to the violence, indeed, this issue is not so simple. It is mentioned in our criteria, particularly what we consider violence or what we don't consider violence. As to the property damage, usually it refers to the category of violence, apart from the cases when this damage is symbolic. Of course, when some symbols are destroyed, this could be considered the expression of opinion, but when property damaged, somebody's property is damaged as a tool of pressure, could not be recognized as justified measure or justified the way of using violence. Of course, it varies, but here's the logic. You may or may not agree with this, but I'm telling you what we were based on our opinion upon. This is a logic not only shared by us, but it's the logic based on the international experience. As to the if we don't recognize the person as political prisoner, we justify the actions that happen to them. As you said, I disagree with that. We call a spade a spade. If to the people there are awful things happening with them, in terms of violence, detentions, and torture. We call it exactly what it is. I describe it exactly as it is. All the measures that we apply in such cases are applied here, but we just simply do not call this that they are political prisoners. We're not saying there are no issues, it's no problem. There are a lot of other tools to reflect this problem. The calling person or recognizing person as political prisoners is not the only tool here. It's important here, you know, when the discussions about capital punishment and in the opinions that if you're against capital punishment, you approve it. No, there's a wide range of approaches here. The stem is here. The range is wide. There are a lot of issues. And recognition of as political prisoners is one of the tools that is applied. It is the most serious issue here. Consequently, it requires serious attention. As to this person driving the car, I believe there were several cases like this. And I might be wrong here, but we did recognize one of them as political prisoner because the nature of such activities shows that this person was trying to run away. That were committing the crimes. He was not trying to hide. He was driving slowly, did not inflict any serious injuries. So this was not violence as such. This fit into the description of the so-called justifiable defense. So we did not believe it was the unnecessary violence. Thank you very much. Олег Агеев, do you want anything to add? Do you have anything to add regarding this or the situation in general? I fully agree with the fact that the criteria of political prisoner is one of the tools and one of the attempts to protect lots of people whose rights have been violated. And the torture victim is another category that is discussed by the human rights community, demanding responsibility for this. Human rights defenders discuss it every day when it comes to the Belarusian regime. If we talk about the human right violation factor, such, this factor alone is not enough to recognize a person as political prisoner. However, wrongly it may sound, I don't want to sound as a person who wants to deprive people of their rights. Indeed, there should be a number of factors that playing together. The person needs to be jailed to get the status, and the criteria should be political. This is all very well described in the guidelines and should be considered. Based on the procedures that we have, I believe Vadim, the process, the example that you gave, indeed falls under the category of political prisoner if the person is detained and if they're persecuted for that. This video was very popular. When a person was trying to avoid getting injured and getting his car damaged, this example shows that this person should be recognized as political prisoner if they are arrested and persecuted for this. All the other charges against him, like the alimony, evasion, or contraband of drugs, drug trafficking, should require us to be more scrupulous while research in his case. Because the criteria of politically motivated persecution is something that needs to be researched in each and every case. And without the confirmation, without the approval, it's hard to say that everyone can be put into this category of political prisoners because they fight against the regime and jailed. Only this approach alone is not enough to put people in the category of political prisoners. Thank you. Thank you, Oleg. Vyacheslav, remembers the last name of the driver and the circumstances of the case. Tikhon Osipov is his name, and he has been recognized as a political prisoner. So this case, I believe, is quite clear-cut. I would shift the focus to the case of Autochovich. Well, the conclusion of Human Rights Coalition is based on the videos filmed by the propaganda channels, where part of the people is recognized, another part is not recognized, based on the videos published on the propaganda channels. Again, I don't understand the decisions about such cases. I have a plethora of those. I just wanted to clarify one thing about the political prisoners and about them being one of the number of the cases. Indeed, it is one of them, but it's a very important one. When you're saying that we're doing the same, colleagues, every time I read the social feed, I see the growing number of the political prisoners. My questions are, it is official, and who made this official recognition? Who passed this verdict? Next, this number. All the news channels show this number. People use it to go to the protest. International politicians mention this figure. It is this figure and not any other. The people who are not on this list are not accounted for. They may be jailed in Belarus jail. Some information about them may be mentioned on some website. They're simply criminals, and we disagree with this. Going back to the commentary by Oleg Gulak, who said that some proposals can be made, the coalition could discuss it. Well, in the past, we could do this. Well, officially, there was one person who was recognized politically as prisoner, but unofficially, there were about five. Well, in the past, we were asking our colleagues to recognize others, but currently, the rhetoric is different. There are recognized as political prisoners, but recognized as another coalition. There's a number of other experts whom we work with. And we believe there's a different approach. We have recognized them as political prisoners. What we do now is need to agree on our approaches. Of course, we will continue our cooperation, but most importantly, we need to help people. One of our main tasks is to make people visible, to show that people are not just criminals, and not to try as some political force to leave them alone. We need to show them the corridor of possibilities. The people are tortured for their political views, which means that people in these cases are clearly political prisoners. Thank you very much. I have a short remark about this. I think it's wrong. To say that recognition as political prisoner should improve the good name of the person and the renome. I think the fact of the charge and the arrest should not mean that the person is a criminal. And because this is a violation of the presumption of innocence until the person is convicted, they are not a criminal. This is very important. As to the recognition as or non-recognition of political prisoners imposes any way of protecting people's rights, I think it's a wrong application, because I believe the people should protect their rights anyway. Because I remember we, on the eve of the mass protest actions, we urged all the participants of this process to refrain from violence, to be peaceful. I still support this approach. However, each and everyone acts the way they should be acting, and but some people do violate the rights and should be treated accordingly. And the use of the political prisoner status for this is too far-fetched. But I think we should have other people speaking. Anton, I believe we do have raised hands among other participants for discussion. Indeed, I would like to give floor to Anais Marin. Anais, please, the floor is yours. Unfortunately, we cannot either see or hear you. But while you're getting ready, we have Olga Zulinska from Prava для жизни, Right to Life. Hello, can you hear me? Yes. Olga Zazek, good evening, everyone. It was very interesting to hear you. I have a question to Oleg Nikolaevich Kulak. You are saying that recognition of people as political prisoners is the way to characterize the situation. Let's say, look at it some other ways. Today in the country, we don't have volunteers that could come to court sessions, and law defenders cannot make any information public because documents they sign. How can we really say that the human rights defenders have enough information to provide enough facts about the situation about every case? Because currently we have the following. We have some information that is received from the person charged. We have prosecutors and lawyers. How is this information put together to objectively characterize the situation, describe the situation that could lead to the status of political prisoner being applied to this or that person, or being rejected? I know that there are some volunteers working in this area, but I guess many people are trying to not be particularly very public about this. You rightly said that the issue, the number of issues is problems is growing, and there is less information, and it's difficult to deal with this. But It's not about us rejecting the status of political prisoner to anyone. It's not a court case that should end with this status being applied or rejected. If there are no reasons, no information about that, this process could last longer, could be postponed or discussed later. When the new information appears, we could go back to this. But I believe that meanwhile, currently we still have a possibility to collect information. This mechanism does work. Personally, I believe that if there's no such possibility at all, will not mean that people should be automatically recognized, should not be recognized as political prisoners. It should be, will be, it will be more difficult to do. Please continue, Oleg. We have technical difficulties. It just will just mean that it'll be difficult to do, but it doesn't change the approach to the procedure of applying the status of a political prisoner. It's important not to use the presumption of innocence sometimes. Sometimes if we consider that the presumption of innocence should be used towards anyone, there should not be the status of a political prisoner. I believe everyone should then be considered a political prisoner. Anais Marin, please, the floor is yours. Good evening, can you hear me now? I'm glad to see all of you here today. I have two questions. They may not be particularly relevant, but please answer them. The first question is, what do you think about the proposals of Vladimir Karamurza regarding the creation of the special rapporteur of the OSCE on political prisoners in Belarus? I think he mentioned this in Warsaw several months ago. Some of you were at that meeting. I don't know how real is this is. We know about the delays that the OSCE makes, but what do you think of this? And is there a hope? My second question is about the so-called godparents. When foreign politicians say that they assume responsibility for this or that particular political prisoner, do you think this possibly affects on their status in prison? This has not led to any people being released in the United Nations. We're worried by the fact that if the person has an international status, focuses or this or that political prisoner, this could lead to a double-edged sword situation, and it doesn't play in the hands of the political prisoner. What do you think of this? Thank you, Anais. I see that Vyacheslav had commentary on this. I would like to use my position to say that if I'm considered political prisoner, please help the family members. But I would like to be my case to be public. Viacheslav, please, you wanted to comment on this. I wanted to say that indeed, some people have rejected the status with held the status of political prisoner. Anishuk is the case when a person was first tortured for 4 hours and then filmed by the police. In the video, he says that my political views were wrong. They just spoiled the tires and damaged the car. Before that, they were rejected the status of political prisoner. The presumption of innocence of the state. It is possible, but then the person is tortured. We know as human rights defenders how it's happened. One thing is when a person is wrongfully accused, wrongfully convicted. Another thing is when you are convicted for expressing your political views, reposting some information, because the country is experiencing the military coup. Going back to the godparents, I think it's a great project. We did a similar thing, but we're trying to be more practical here. We have the guardians. We understand how people's family members are pressured, how much they are under pressure. And we're trying to connect the person who can help someone with money and give somebody a lift with the people who require this attention. They drink tea and they receive the practical help. We have about 200 people like that. We actively cooperate with organizations provide such help. And what our proposal is to connect the agency of saviors to the agency of godparents, because the saviors know a lot about the person's family members, and this is very important. I think this is great, and we're moving in this direction.
Спасибо. Я, наверное, я по относительно того, что говорила госпожа Анна Исмарин, конечно же.
As to what Anna Исмарин said. I believe that any mechanism that could help people get released, particularly those charged under political articles, is great. We need to consider the mandate. And only if this mandate is applied properly, this should be welcomed. The Institute of the Godparents currently practice by a number of politicians these days is of course great help and sign of solidarity. I would say that at some meetings I give such examples to other politicians and propose other politicians to use it to express their solidarity and to improve the situation with the political prisoners in Belarus. I have a question again to all of us here regarding the situation that what we have these days. While we were discussing, I browsed the Viasna website, and based on the criteria, there are 927 people recognized as political prisoners at the Dissident BY. There are 1,151 people. The difference here is about the people that whose cases were either not considered or were rejected. It's a big number of people. My question is, to everyone. How do you see the situation developing? Should we in future have a group of human defense organizations that are guided by the criteria passed in 2013 and the group of other organizations that will be guided by their own criteria? And this will lead to the creation of two lists.
Отличие между этими списками.
I believe that 224 people show there's a difference between such lists. Or is everyone present here interested in unifying their approaches and either have the similar approaches to recognizing people as political prisoners or leaving things as they are?
Спасибо. Мне кажется, это очень важный вопрос. Прямо так перехватил бы инициативу, потому что действительно надо разобраться.
Indeed, I agree with Oleg, with what Oleg said. We need to understand what we're aiming at. These two lists, is it okay? It's fine. Should this situation remain? Should this difference remain? Or is there an interest among the coalition members? To unify the approaches and to have a big coalition with two different lists. Or maybe everyone is fine with this situation. What do you think of this? Vyacheslav, Oleg Gulak, who could comment on this?
Vyacheslav, пожалуйста.
Я, да? Хорошо, спасибо. Смотрите, я, во-первых, вижу вообще это позитивным моментом, да?
I see this as a positive thing when there's a clash of opinions. It leads to change. Some people may lose track of what is happening, may get swallowed by the events, not keep up to date. It's great that there's a discussion and there's a clash of opinions. We're all civilized people here. Hopefully we'll have something good coming out of our session or meeting. For us, it's not a problem. We have been working for a while and we have a lot of work to do. The only thing we insist upon, what is important for us, is that the media outlets currently, since our colleagues and their organizations was the only the driver of all this, everything was concentrated upon them. They were bearing the toil. The journalists referred to their lists, and us and our colleagues are not happy that the 200 plus people remain invisible. The people and their family members have suffered. And it's not 224 people anymore, it's 500 people or even more. It's only those that we know about. It's a huge number of people who are under repression and they're tortured and so on and so forth. We want the figures to be full, be proper. As to the unclear criteria, I would like to repeat myself and say that we're still referring to the base criteria. We just want the approach of this criteria to be changed based on what I said earlier. What you said about the mass media outlets referring to this list, it's clear. I want to understand whether this question should be asked of the coalition. Maybe we should discuss this with our colleagues from that coalition. Mass media are free to refer to any coalition they want.
Да, Вячеслав, вижу, поднят руку, так включать микрофон и отвечать, да.
Да, я просто сразу тогда отвечу. На самом деле...
I will reply. Thank you for asking this. Before the initiative came around in 2019, in 2016 or 2017, we did our best.
Своих там вот этих внутренних движений мы постоянно писали представителям.
We were constantly writing to the representatives of the coalition, including the Human Rights Center Viasna. We were constantly trying to have a discussion with them. We were not heard by them. We were knocking from them. I see nothing bad about two lists existing side by side. It's the people who are the bearers of power. It's not about the media outlets, it's about the... It's important to be explained to the international community. There could be two lists. However, I would like to remind you, we don't have any conflict between the coalition, particularly with those experts who have been doing their thing for a long time. We just disagree on certain points that we're discussing at sessions like this one. And then we should decide together. Oleg Nikolaevich, I may be provocative now, but I'm not a human defense activist. But from what I heard, I had the feeling that the issue is about there being the old coalition, about the young coalition, the old coalition having a long established methodology and the list of contacts, the politicians become patrons. And there is a new coalition which involves the young people who urge the wider criteria. Is there a generation gap? We have an expert discussion today. Maybe we should have a more working discussion and think about different approaches and maybe creating a wider coalition or having two coalitions, which is not an issue. That's a very good question. The discussions on this topic have happened in the past, involving different representatives of various camps. Like Vyacheslav said, it happened in 2019 and even before that. But some say there may be a generation gap, but I think it's about the meaning.
It will
be beneficial if we know more about the people who have suffered on political reasons. The more there are people in the lists, the more there are lists of people with information about people who suffered illegally, unlawfully. The human rights website of Viasna accumulates this information. It's an aggregator. of the information on this topic that deserve attention. The more such information we have, the less, the fewer there will be gaps, white spots in the issue of the political persecution. And without a doubt, all the actions of the authorities towards the people who disagree with the political course fraught with political persecution. This is a problem because the procedures are not followed. This issue should be raised, and the more people raise it, the better. On the other hand, there should be understanding of responsibility. We use the approach, do not harm, not harming the people we're trying to help. We understand that they may suffer, affected by the authorities, and also we try not to do harm in applying our guidelines. This is a new initiative for me, so I'm not ready to react to what people are saying here. But we need to consider the fact that a lot of people recognized as political prisoners could lead to such a list getting less important. When we adopted the criteria for this, we remembered that there is a term, the prisoner of conscience, a term used by the Amnesty International. We don't have a moral right to replace this term with a political prisoner, with the term of political prisoner. If there are several lists with clear-cut criteria, it will be fine. The journalists will be able to understand what's going on, and everybody interested in making statements about this will use this information, but we need to consider the nuances. But unification should happen if there's a serious platform used for this. For example, I don't see any problems of cooperating with colleagues about the potential approaches to help people under political pressure. But talking about the widening or increasing the number of criteria is a different thing. I think everybody is still holding to their opinion, and the general amendments will not help us solve this issue. Thank you, Oleg. I will read the questions from the chat, because we'll have a YouTube version. There'll be no questions in the chat there, and I believe they're important. Vadim Goretsky from the Association of Journalists wrote that he has been participating in such discussion for over a year. And he would like to hear about the 10 cases when the family members were turning to the coalition to get the status of the political prisoner and why they were rejected. Was this about the drugs or something else? I don't think it's about 10, but we have a number of cases. I can name a few right now where the relatives turned to us and they were rejected. And the case of Anishchuk is one of them. The attack on Azarenok is also one of them. So there's a number of cases like that. Please call us and contact us, and we will share our views with that. On that, we'd like to give floor to Alexander Mirzaitov, please. Hello, can you hear me? It'd be great if you turn on your cam. My name is Alexander. I have two questions. You spoke a lot about violence. And you said if a person applies violence, they cannot be recognized as a political prisoner. If the person in the past had objective issues with law, could have issues with the law enforcement bodies, and at some point in his past, he ended up in a situation where he did not apply any violence, but could be recognized as political prisoner. Could his past affect this decision? We're constantly talking about this status, recognition and non-recognition. We're all people. People are prone to making mistakes. How do you minimize the subjective factor in passing this status? These are my two questions. Thank you. We'll start with Vyacheslav. Well, my first answer is that if the person has problems with the law before the situation where he could be recognized as a political prisoner, it shouldn't affect the situation, because otherwise it's called discrimination. We should evaluate the situation, concrete case, why this person was tortured or illegally convicted. Everything else is not of interest to us, neither the gender or sex or anything else. The second question was about the minimizing subjective factor. Right, I think it will fall under the discrimination practices and the category of discrimination practices. They shouldn't be applied in any case. If they're used to pass a verdict about this or that prisoner, and until there is a democratic court, until there is a democratic authorities, till the lawyers, proper lawyers, who are not afraid of getting jailed, before that, the person should receive some assistance and should be treated later in detail. We have several cases like that. We already discussed the status of political prisoner. And the person in the courtroom found out that he was persecuted for the things that did not make. And I believe it's better now to recognize the person as a political prisoner. This is the presumption of innocence. It's inalienable right of humans, according to the Human Rights Declaration. this will make this person visible for the community, and personal convictions should play no role. Therefore, we are particularly offended by the particular line of behavior to get this status, according to Alice Bilavsky. I think it happened 3 years ago. He said that if you get beaten or murdered, just do not resist. We don't think it's proper, particularly considering the today's realities of Belarus. Thank you. Thank you for your question, Alexander. But let's start with the second question: how to avoid the subjective approach, how to avoid being subjective. I don't see the better ways of avoiding subjective approaches, but to be joined in decisions. And I agree with Oleg Gulak, who said that currently the communicator of the cases reviewed by the human rights community that gave the person the status of political prisoner. The criteria why this person received the status are publicly available. There is a particular statements that describe why this status was given to this or that person. And this is observed even if several people are recognized as political citizens, political prisoners. So this is all available, and you can spread this information. As to the first question, this is very important. Indeed, when there are criteria, the person who in the past committed crimes and later became involved in political activities was detained and drawn to responsibility, I believe it does not make him a political prisoner. And the other way around, if the person was involved in activities and was later drawn to responsibility, does not mean that they get the status of political prisoner, unless it's proven that this persecution is directly connected with their activity. It stems from the criteria, from the limitations described in the guidelines. Hence, I cannot agree with the approach that it's better to give somebody a status of political prisoner and then to cancel it later. It leads to the blurring of this notion and to the devaluation of it. When people who received it and deserved it, where the big number of people when the people make the list who are not really political prisoners, towards others there will be a devaluation. So I believe we should avoid this approach. We want the recognition to be proper and to be objective. But I will repeat myself, it does not mean that these people should be rejected assistance. The status of political prisoners is one of the ways to protect the rights of people. It's one of the mechanisms. If the people's rights are violated and the person is not a political prisoner, is not recognized as such, doesn't mean that they should not be protected and defended. They should be provided assistance, but they should not be automatically considered as political prisoners. Oleg Gulak, you wanted to add something. I wanted to add that, please be brief, because we have two more people wanted to ask questions. Oleg mentioned the criteria. It's not only the criteria that matter, but also the transparency of it and the arguments given in favor of this decision to recognize people as political prisoners. It is clear from the motivation what was the reason. This could be argued upon. This is the main instrument to avoid subjectiveness. Unfortunately, it's not like a court with their procedures. So the value of such recognition is based only on the authority, based on a number of factors. Thank you. Thank you very much. I see, and from Olga Zurizka, Country for Life. Just a small remark from me. I heard about the criteria when we constantly toying with the criteria. We shouldn't change the criteria, we should change the approach. Because we view the same thing in a different way in life. It's time to change the approaches. I think we have just asked this already. So it sounds very much like a charm. I just wanted to answer to Mr. Vyacheslav, who quoted Aleš Beliatsky. Unfortunately, Aleš Beliatsky is not here. I know exactly what Aleš Beliatsky said. Aleš Beliatsky spoke this about the situation when you are getting provoked by the law enforcement agencies, by the KGB. So when you're getting provoked, you should not apply force or violence to the police officer. This way, he says that you will make this situation worse. As to the criteria, these guidelines describe this. They said the message of the person should not be considered. The result should be considered. It's mentioned there. And I can send it to the chat. Indeed, I agree. It is difficult to assess the intentions of people. It's easy, much easier to assess the person's actions. Силовики are also saying their intentions are good. Anton, we also have the raised hand. Vyacheslav should give in a right to answer, and then we'll have one more question. Thank you. As to the provocations, I fully agree with what you're saying, but I insist on what you're saying. If you're getting destroyed, you shouldn't really keep calm. I understand your position. It's just your position does not coincide with ours. It's about number of cases where there were provocations. Dmitry Polyenko and his detention, Svetoslav Baranovich in his case, when he saw some girls were brutally arrested. Those are the blank spaces in the approaches when the person could not receive the status and the attention of the international community and help. That what we all started with. We never said that it is connected with the assistance. This is a new element. Thank you. I see the person wants to ask. Pavel Levin. I have a question. We can read the statements when that confirmed the person was recognized as political prisoner. But where can we read information about the rejection? How many rejections were there? How many approvals were there? Where can this information be found? Can I answer now? Yes, you can. Pavel, this information is not available because it's not written anywhere. It's important to understand here that the procedure of recognizing people as political prisoners is not cut in stone. It's not written in any code. There is no process that says that you need to ask for opinion of a human defense coalition. If somebody needs such consultations and discussions, we do hold them, like today's session. The recognition as a political prisoner is done for a particular reason. If somebody wants to assume the responsibility of describing all the applications that we receive, you're free to do it. Pavel, if you believe that somebody should do it, we should appoint the person for that. But I believe that it's based on misunderstanding of the of this action as such. Thank you. Thank you, Vyacheslav. I believe it's a good initiative. It's a very relevant issue. It's important to understand who was and who wasn't recognized as a political prisoner. We have a database of two lists, two approaches. We all have agreed here that this is all relevant. Based on this, we can work further. It will give us the understanding of what to do next. However, educated our colleagues are, and they form a very closed community. The journalists who write on the political news don't understand who appoints these statuses, who gives those statuses of political business, and this discussion of recognition and non-recognition would be actually great. I think it would understand, give other people, to wide number of people, to understand what approaches are used. People would understand their rights. It is the activity that should be tackled by someone. We do have such cases, particularly those that were rejected by our colleagues' coalition. People who want to do this are welcome to do this. The field is free. But we started here not about legal education.
Смысла просвещения. Цели просвещения мы достигаем или пытаемся достигать.
Goals of the education are achieved by other tools, more effective.
Деятельными, скажем, да, и эффективными, что главное. А вот задачи спорить о
But the tasks of,
мне кажется, лучше все-таки заниматься помощью людям
of arguing about lists should not be highlighted, because we should help people rather than argue whether this person should or should not receive the status of a political prisoner. The time should not... I think we should go back to the meanings. I understand the both sides here.
Ирина Третьякова,
пожалуйста. Ирина Третьякова, wanted to say something.
Да, добрый день, Олег Николаевич. Я уже писала в чате.
Олег Николаевич, I've already brought this in the chat. We are not talking about the bonuses, or we are saying about the situation when the people need to get their status reinstated. Hopefully this will happen soon, and when this, then there will be a different procedures for that, that will pass the decisions at the state level. This is totally different. We should not mix those things together. Vyacheslav, one more. And I'll be brief about whether should the difference should be described, whether to do it or not. If we're saying that one of the major criteria of democratic society is openness, how can we say that openness is not important here, particularly when we talk about the political prisoner status? I don't see any conflicts here. I see that this is very important for people, and the fact that this will be understood to a wider number of people, bigger number of people, is definitely a positive, and the openness is the main principle of what we are doing. Right, let's conclude this session. Well, it's important to help people that we all agree upon. But for me, I understand that the resources are not infinite. And everybody is welcome to apply the resources where they want to. If we had a website, with a description of why people are recognized as political prisoners, and we had a different website that described the criteria why the 200 plus people were not recognized political principles, political prisoners, it would be great. It would make the situation more clear. I'll be brief. Going back to the safety and security, those 200 people that we did not give the status of political prisoners, they are currently jailed. Do you think it's the right way for us to make public the information about them, regarding why the and the reasons why we did not give them the status of political prisoners? So the principle of do no harm is important here.
признать более заключенным, если кто-то считает, что он китайский, не готов выносить дальше правительственного сообщества, чтобы не навредить этому человеку, ну, в общем-то, это можно понять.
And I fully understand what you're saying, but since we are not a human rights defense forum, but it would be great that we should hold joint activities. Most importantly, our test today was to understand what is happening. And I think the situation became clear. We saw today the different approaches, some opinions, but our task was to understand each other. And for those of us, for those who will watch on YouTube, I think that hopefully you managed to understand what we discussed today. I would like to thank everyone who participated in this discussion. According to Chatham House, the human rights defenders are on the top in the list of top position among the media outlets and the independence media and lawyers that received gained the trust and enjoyed the trust of people. I would like to thank you for your work. In the chat already, we'll be happy. We wrote that on the 23rd of December, we'll have the final session of the analytical club. We'll be making conclusions of the year 2021 and discuss the forecast for 2022. Indeed, considering the year that is ending, the first question will be, the first issue raised will be about the repression. So we urge everyone to join our discussion. Thank you, everyone, and see you later. Thank you. Goodbye.